Good evening. Today is Monday, August 1st. This is the Cabarrus County Board of Education work session. I'll now call this meeting to order. Board members, it's time to set the agenda. Before we accept a motion to set the agenda, I have two agenda items that I need to add. The first one is going to be agenda item 4.2A, which is adopt the 2016-17 budget. Ms. Klutz will be talking about that one. The second item is to move 4.4, which is the beginning teacher support plan with Ms. Angela Wood. We're going to move that in front of item 3.1 if no one has any objections to that. So do I have a motion to make those agenda changes? Mr. Furr and Mr. Harrison. Mr. Furr makes the motion. Mr. Harrison seconds that. Any discussion?
Do we have the budget?
Ms. Klutz, do you have the budget?
I emailed it to all board members that for me something.
We need to check our email?
Yes.
Okay.
Michael has it now.
Okay, so it will be presented. All right, so now, any other discussion? Seeing none, all in favor of accepting the adjustments to the agenda as noted, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, say no. Okay, that amendment passes 5-0. And then now that we have an amended agenda, all in favor, I need a motion to adopt the amended agenda. Dr. Phillips, Mr. Harrison, any more discussion? Okay, seeing none, all in favor of adopting the amended agenda, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That motion carries 5-0. That moves us to item 4.4 that got moved up, and Ms. Angela Wood is going to present to us about the beginning teacher support plan.
Good evening. We take great pride in Cabarrus County in supporting the growth and development of our new teachers. It is required that we annually review our beginning teacher support program, so this will look similar to what we reviewed last year. And the beginning teacher support program is housed in the Human Resources Department. Our key personnel in the Human Resources Department include our Assistant Superintendent of HR, Ms. Glenda Jones, Human Resources Director, Dr. Keisha Khan, and myself as the Human Resources Coordinator. But most importantly, most of the work is done at the school level, and that includes the school-based administrators, both principals and assistant principals, lead mentors, and mentors. Our new teachers are invited to a three-day orientation, and this orientation includes information about our Cabarrus County leadership, a training on teaching evaluation standards and the process, as well as information about the beginning teacher requirements. The professional development offered during these 3 days includes classroom management, as well as information about curriculum and instruction, and that piece is designed by our curriculum instruction department. And our new teachers will receive resources including The First Days of School by Harry Wong, and that book will be incorporated into some of the professional development that day, as well as the Electronic New Teacher Handbook, which will include resources from the 3 days so that they can access that material at a later time if needed. For our lateral entry teachers, we provide additional resources for them, as well as during the new employee orientation, we have a separate session for them. These are the teachers that have not student taught before, so we have an extra session for them about how to set up your classroom and really get started that first week of school. And then we also have a monthly professional learning community where they meet throughout the year and discuss topics such as classroom management, curriculum, and we have lots of different speakers that come in to support them throughout the year. For our lateral entry teachers, we also have a two-week orientation for those that are hired after August, so that they are provided that support before they begin in the classroom. And that 2 weeks is giving them an opportunity to observe in other schools, to observe our great teaching in Cabarrus County schools. They will receive the first-year teacher's survival guide by Julia Thompson. And in this guide, it will provide us a guide basically for our PLC meetings throughout the year. And that's a lot of the work that we do in our PLC meetings comes from that book. During our new employee orientation this year, we are excited again to have the Cabarrus Regional Chamber of Commerce sponsoring a lunch on August 16th. And we will also have Kannapolis City Schools joining us that day this year. We also have the North Carolina Teacher of the Year, Mr. Bobby Kavnar, will be coming to do our keynote address to our first-year teachers. So that should be an exciting time with him. The teachers also have a school orientation, so our administrators, principals, assistant principals, and lead mentors work together to organize a school orientation for the new teachers to their school. So during this time, it will really be an opportunity to acclimate the new teachers to the school, to get them to know their mentors, to give them an opportunity to work with their mentors. This will be held during one of the 8 workdays, since we have additional workdays during this calendar year. For the different levels of support, as I mentioned earlier, the Human Resources houses the beginning teacher support plan. So we facilitate looking at the plan, reviewing the plan, and also the district orientation. We serve as the liaison to DPI and offer mentor training. This past year, we trained 135 new mentors, and we are up to 575 current employees who are trained as mentors to use as resources. We also serve as a liaison to the lead mentors, BTs, and mentors. We make sure that our beginning teachers have the documentation needed in their beginning teacher file, and this is going to include the quarterly checklist, the orientation checklist, the mentor contract, lead mentor contract, etc. For teacher licensure, we ensure that we have that documentation in place so that at the end of year 3, these teachers are prepared to move from an initial license to a continuing license. And then we also facilitate the BTSP, the Beginning Teacher Program, review from DPI and the Title II evaluation. At the school level, again, most important level, our administrators are the ones who assign the mentors. So this is typically decided upon by the principal or assistant principal, and they're really trying to make the best match they possibly can. So they're looking for teachers who have the same subject areas, who teach the same subject areas or grade levels, have common planning, someone who can really be a great support for this new teacher. And the mentors must have a minimum of 3 years of successful teaching. They're going to monitor the process throughout the year and provide coaching and support as needed to those new teachers to make sure they're getting what they need. And then our lead mentors at every school, we have a lead mentor, and they are going to be working closely with the administrators at the school, and they also serve as my contact person from HR to the schools. And so oftentimes information is distributed to the lead mentors that they distribute to the mentors and the beginning teachers. And they're going to coordinate with the administrators to look for opportunities for professional development that will suit the needs of the teachers in their specific school. And then they also oversee the documentation for the new teachers to make sure that we have that documentation needed for their beginning teacher file. I did ask a couple of them this year if they would they had anything that they would like to share. And one of the quotes that stood out to me was from a lead mentor, "I was able to see new teachers gain confidence and grow by working with their mentors. I also saw mentors grow by working with their mentees." So I thought that was very important to point out that it's a very reciprocal relationship. The mentors want to be mentors because they're excited about supporting the new teachers, but they also learn so much from our new teachers. For the mentors are really the key people working with these beginning teachers. So we ask that they meet weekly with the beginning teachers. This is documented through the quarterly checklist, and they also are there to support the new teachers in whatever way they can. So depending on the needs of that new teacher, it may be lesson planning, maybe classroom management, maybe instructional strategies. It might be how to communicate with parents, how to communicate in their professional learning communities. It's really whatever way they can, they are there to support that teacher. So at the end of this year, I ask all beginning teachers to provide advice for our next cohort of first-year teachers. And I thought it was very interesting to read their advice to our first-year teachers, but many of the quotes that they sent us had to do with their mentors and the support that they were provided throughout the year. So for example, stay in close connection with your mentor as well as surrounding teachers. Use the people at your school for support. Keep communication open with your mentor. Don't be afraid to ask for help or answers. And I think this really says a lot for the support that we provide to our beginning teachers and how important that relationship is to them to have a close relationship with their mentor. So for the mentor standards, in the mentor training, we teach the mentor standards and we look for ways to help the mentors support the new teachers on these standards. So the mentor standards are aligned directly to the 5 North Carolina teaching standards. So it's basically supporting the new teachers in helping them meet their goals in their North Carolina teaching evaluation rubric. So we also have an annual review where we meet with Lincoln County and Stanley County. Those are the two assigned to us by DPI. And we basically trade our beginning teacher support plans, review one another's plans, and give each other feedback. It's a great way to share what we're doing in our county with other counties. And then every 5 years, we have a review from DPI. They will come and review our beginning teacher support plan. So for the evaluation process of our beginning teachers, all of our beginning teachers, years 1 through 3, are on the comprehensive evaluation plan. And so that includes all of these things noted up here. So that includes a self-assessment at the beginning of the year. And this is for all teachers. All teachers will do a self-assessment. It's basically going through the teacher evaluation rubric to make sure to see where they think they are. And they're going to use that information to develop their goals for their professional development plan. So the professional development plan is something they're going to follow up on all year. And they meet with their mentor and their administrator to review the goals at the beginning of the year, at the middle of the year, and at the end of the year. They will also have 3 full administrative observations. And the first one must include a pre-conference. And these full observations must be a minimum of 45 minutes each. And then they will have a post-conference with an administrator after each of these observations. They have 1 peer observation, which is either another teacher or a lead teacher, somebody other than a full-time administrator, will do a full observation, and they observe on all of the observable elements. So anything that can be seen in the classroom is marked in the rubric. And this should not be by the mentor, because the mentor is there for support. So the peer observer is someone other than the mentor, so that that mentor can truly be the supportive role. And then at the end of the year, for our comprehensive, for our teachers on the comprehensive plan, it's required that the principal do the summary evaluation. And so that summary evaluation is a culmination of the professional development plan goals and all of the observations throughout the year, as well as what they have seen throughout the year. And so at the end of the year, they're rating the teacher on all 5 standards, either developing, proficient, accomplished, or distinguished. So from William A. Ward, the mediocre teacher tells, the good teacher explains, the superior teacher demonstrates, and the great teacher inspires. So it is our goal to provide support for our beginning teachers so that they can in turn inspire all of their students to be lifelong learners. And that is all I have, unless there's any questions.
Board members, do any of you have questions for Ms. Woods? Up.
Are board members invited to that luncheon? I know in the past we have been.
We never
turned down opportunity for free food.
Board members are invited. This is your formal invitation to the luncheon. It is. I will send you details tomorrow.
Does our teacher liaison participate in this program?
Being able to share what I've learned for so many years with a mentee is just such a great experience.
You just have one mentee and one mentor, or is it multiple?
One.
Is it a one-to-one?
Our goal is for it to be one-to-one. Every now and then, depending on the size of the school, that could differ, but for the most part, it is one-to-one.
OK.
had a question for Kelly. It says here there's a dollar amount of $124,000. What does all that entail?
I do have the breakdown of that if you would like to see it. Last year, the dollar amount was $95,000, and when we looked back at that, that did not include my benefits, because included in this is my salary, as it's part of the Title II. It's how it's laid out by Title II. So the majority of that...
Well, it includes your salary, and it includes the new teacher orientation
yes.
expenditures, as well as the supplies and things that we do for training with mentors and mentees.
So it also includes the, when we do mentor training, they get a substitute for the day. So with 135 teachers being trained with mentor training, that's $105 a day, essentially, because they have a substitute for a full day. It also includes subs for observations. So we provide each school enough time for each new teacher to observe an experienced teacher. So they are provided a substitute for a block or two so that they have an opportunity to go and observe. And so it's covering substitutes for that piece of it. And then also for, we have a makeup orientation. So for that makeup orientation for new teachers hired after August, it also covers their substitutes. So those substitutes are a big big part of that cost. And then our new teacher orientation as well, and the supplies for that and the books for that.
And that's all. We've all been doing that. Just the salary is the big difference between this year and last.
The only difference, there really isn't a difference in my salary. The difference is we didn't include the benefits piece when we did the calculation last year. We only included my base salary. And when we looked at including the benefits piece, that's what increased it so much.
Okay. You talked about the presentation about the first year teacher. What happens in year two and three? Is this a three-year program? Is that...
So in years two and three, the first year they go to the orientation. In years two and three, they continue with a mentor. The goal is for them to continue with the same mentor for 3 years. So in it, basically the requirements just change slightly each year. So the first year they're required to do an orientation checklist, which has a lot of the basic information that a first year teacher would need, in addition to the quarterly checklist with their mentor. And in year two, they'll meet weekly with their mentor as well and do the orientation checklist. So the only thing that changes is that orientation checklist goes away. And then in year three, it's essentially a buddy. And it's not quite as formal. There is a mentor contract, but there is a person there to provide support for them in year three. They're not required to submit any documentation.
And those are guidelines by the state that tells us what to do for that, or is that something that we've come up with as part of our plan?
That's something that we've come up with as part of our plan.
Okay. How many first-year teachers do we anticipate this year?
We currently have 50... I believe it was 56 when I looked this morning, first-year teachers. So those would be coming to the orientation for all 3 days. So that is less than last year. I think we had about 75 last year.
Okay, I'm trying to see what other questions I had. Last, had something about, one of the emails that we got had about extracurricular activities that you don't assign the first 3 years. How does that work? What is that?
Yes, so by the state asks that if a new teacher participates in an extracurricular activity, that it be voluntary and by choice. So there, we have a form that the new teachers are signing saying that they want to be a track coach, or they want to have this extra club after school.
That's what we saw. You sent us a form.
That was the form, yes, sir.
Okay. All right, well, I appreciate your efforts in that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions? All right, board members, are we going to consent or action? Consent? All right, move it to consent.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. All right, that brings us to item 3.1 on the consent agenda, and that is the approval of policies on the first reading. Ms. Reimer and Ms. Burns are going to come forward and talk to us. Board members, do you have, since these are all PLS updates, do you happen to have an overall report that just kind of summarizes what this looks like? All right.
Yes.
Thank you.
So you can go through each one and explain what the changes are to them?
Are you talking on first read?
Yes.
We have... I can certainly do that, but there's probably, 20 21 on first read, 16 to 20. That's what the board wishes, then that's...
Didn't we used to have a summary sheet that would show all the PLS updates on one sheet? Or was that a couple of years ago that we used to get?
I thought that was in your board docs, and it looked like this.
Okay.
Or it was sent prior to, it was sent out last week, so I'm pretty sure, I thought she put it in board docs. It was sent out to everyone. She might not have added it.
While we're looking at that, one thing I would mention is that we're working with technology and our website to actually put these policies that we're looking at on our website, and an opportunity for parents to comment on those that are up for change, and then it would automatically email Sue or myself to get any kind of feedback from parents. So a different way to communicate as well.
I think that's a good idea. As soon as that, if you can explain that to the public when it's live, I'd like to see that.
Okay.
But if we could go through these, since obviously there's nothing here that tells us what the changes are, I'd like to know what the changes are, and I think the public would too.
Yeah, that has been emailed, but it's not in board docs today, evidently, so. Can do that one instead? Okay. All right, policy 1710, 4021, and 7230. This is a PLS strongly recommended change. It broadens the definition of harassment and bullying in subsection C2 to be consistent with case law, interpreting federal and anti-discrimination statutes. Policy 1720, 4015, and 7225. This is a PLS model policy replacing the following that was striked. The change was recommended by the CCS board attorney as well. Policy 2300, our board meetings. This is a PLS recommended and strongly recommended change. Substantially revises the policy to clarify three types of meeting the board, the meetings that the board may hold under law. Regular, specially called, and emergency. It updates legal references. Policy 3000, goals and objectives of the educational program. This is a PLS strongly recommended and recommended change. Replaces opening statement with a statement incorporating the Leandro standard. It updates title of the school accreditation body. Updates references to the basic education program. Adds three new goals to reflect the North Carolina Supreme Court's decision of a sound basic education. And then other minor edits. Policy 30.
Does it say what those three goals are?
It does in the policy. Policy 3430, this is a PLS strongly recommended and recommended change. It substitutes North Carolina Math 1 for Algebra 1 in subsection B to reflect the current course titles. In paragraph B2I, adds a required element to the school improvement plan applicable to certain schools as identified as focus schools by DPI. In paragraph B3, it deletes the option to include the school improvement as a request for waivers of state laws, rules, or policies, and other minor edits that were recommended. Policy 5000 is a PLS strongly recommended and recommended change, adds statements regarding the board's duty when making policy decisions to consider its obligations under Leandro to provide students with a sound basic education. Policy 6000, this is a PLS strongly recommended and recommended change, modifies the first sentence to incorporate the Leandro standard, minor edits. Policy 7100, recruitment and selection of personnel. This is a PLS required, strongly recommended, and recommended change. Adds Leandro statement, section A, that all employee decisions will be consistent with the board's objective of providing students with a sound basic education. Revised provisions on nepotism to be consistent with the new state law, which was effective March 1. Policy 7405, extracurricular and non-instructional duties. This is a PLS required change. Removes exemption from extracurricular duty assignments for teachers with 27 or more years of experience in accordance with the change to the state statute. Policy 7810, evaluations of licensed employees, adds statement regarding access to EVOS data by teachers as required by the new state law, updates legal references. Policy 7920, that's a PLS recommended and required change, retitles the policy, limits the application of this policy to employees who have a right to statutory RIF procedures, modifies item C1 to track new state requirements, and updates the legal references. Policy 8000 is physical goals. This is a PLS strongly recommended and recommended change. Adds Leandro's statement to all financial decisions that will be consistent with the board's objective of providing students with sound basic education, and minor edits. Policy 8100, budget planning and adoption. This is a PLS strongly recommended and recommended change. Modifies paragraph A1 to incorporate the board's Leandro duty, and minor edits recommended. Policy 8510, school finance officer. This is a PLS strongly recommended change. Add duties related to disbursements in accordance with the law.
Thank you very much. Ms. Stone, they talk an awful lot about Leandro for the public's purpose. What exactly is that? And why do we have to make all these changes to all those policies?
Certainly, Leandro is the very case probably went on for a little over 5 years, perhaps a little bit longer, challenge to the state and whether or not there was adequate funding being provided. Without getting into the full history of the litigation, the Supreme Court came out and said that it's a constitutional duty under the state of North Carolina's constitution that students be provided with a sound basic education, and went into some discussion as to what that entails. In response to that, the General Assembly has adopted that language in many places in the North Carolina General Statutes. And it's the recommendation of the policy service from the School Board Association that we mirror and include many of those changes in our own local policies, so that that obligation always is at sort of the forefront in terms of what the responsibilities are.
Thank you.
All right, board members, does anybody have any problem with any of these items? Consent agenda?
Just one last, so if the public is interested or the staff is interested in reading these changes, they are available right now. They're available on board docs, but you said you're gonna
What we would want to do is put a link on our website, probably on the board page, that says these are the policies that the board are currently looking at and getting ready to approve. If you have any feedback, please let us know, and then we'll link that so they can email and we'll send it directly to us. That we hope to have that up and live by next week.
Great, thank you.
All right, consent.
And will that website page have a contact us type of feature to it by which people type in their comments?
Yes, and that'll come directly
Freeform text type of thing.
Yes, and it'll come directly to Sue or I.
Great, thank you.
All right, consent? Okay. All right. Before we move on to the next one, I'd like to recognize our SRO tonight, our Officer Donald Sestoke with A.T. Allen and Mary Frances Wall. Thank you, Donald, for coming out tonight and protecting us, and thank you for all that you're doing. And I know that you're getting ready for August the 29th. Thank you, sir. All right, that moves us to 3.2. That is the approval of policies on the second reading with Ms. Reimer and Ms. Burns.
Okay, questions for that, for his consent?
Well, again, we don't have the list there that describes what the changes are, so I would like to know what those are. I'd like those to go through those.
That was on the last one.
Last week's board docs?
I do not. She says those were in last week's board docs, possibly.
They were in last month's.
Or last month.
Last
month's board docs.
And I do not have a copy of those in front of me right now, since they're on the second read.
But I don't see why we need to review that one, since we went through it in the July 11th meeting. It shouldn't be a rehash of the same thing. That's kind of a little bit redundant, I believe. However, there are some items that I know that we want to go to the action agenda, and I'd like to just get those called out, and then we can focus on those items, if you don't mind. Yeah, and if you want to go back and find the original summary list, Ms. Burns sent an email out on June the 22nd, and that was the policy meeting minutes from 6:21, and in that one is the summary.
But and is it on board docs from last month or not?
I don't know. I wasn't here and didn't look at it.
Do you want me to look? Yeah. I can go look.
But are there any specific, since we it got on consent agenda and moved over to second reading, Are there any items that any of you board members would like to call out and consider for the action agenda? Mr. Powell wrote in an email he would like us to consider 2120 and 2122 for the action agenda. And so I figure we'll have a conversation with him when he gets back rather than trying to do it on the telephone in this meeting.
And I had three I wanted to see on the action as well.
Which one?
3420, 3405, and 2400.
Okay. All right.
Could you repeat those, please?
So we have five items, 2120, 2400, 3405, 3420, and 2122. For the action agenda. And Rob, if you could contact them about 2400, 3405, and 3420 with whatever concerns you have there so that when we have this conversation next time, everybody will be prepared for it.
I'd be happy to.
That way they don't have to think on their feet.
Mr. Shoemaker, I'd also ask that if we have PLS updates that don't include the questions that we have, that we go ahead and approve, and maybe Ms. Stone can speak to that a little bit, the actual PLS update itself, so we can do what we're required to do by the state board, and then revisit that policy so that we can get those through and continue with our others, but we'll continue with that policy and in the policy committee to come back or to answer questions if that's possible. Ms. Stone, would you speak to that, please?
Certainly, I believe this is a procedure we've discussed and made a recommendation at policy committee that when the policies come before the board, to the extent board members have questions or concerns with parts of the policy that are not being changed or added, that the board looks at and considers making whatever the proposed revision is, and if there is a proposed revision or modification to pre-existing language, that then go back to the policy committee. Just so that we can ensure there are a lot of very important statutory changes that happened both last year and this year out of the General Assembly, and the committee really is very quickly trying to play catch-up to get some of these new revisions in place. And so if there is some tweaking of language that people would like to have done to pre-existing language, if we could move the revisions forward, if you all are in agreement, particularly when they are driven by statutory changes, and then the committee can go back and look at other possible tweaks or revisions to the policy at a future meeting. I just think that would help us ensure that, particularly with the start of the school year coming upon us and many statutory changes that are going to need to take effect with the school year, that we are on top of it as best as we can be.
I would like, if we could, to kind of have a scorecard of where we are so we can kind of have a metric as to how far behind, because this year we got way behind the eight ball, and I don't think we realized how far behind we were until sometime in June or late May. And so if next year, as we go forward, kind of lay out all the policies and what, and just kind of give us a little metric on where we are so that we can keep our eye on the ball and not get bogged down in discussion over PLS updates. If we do have genuine changes to the policies, and I agree we should do those, but they need to come back to the policy committee and we need to suggest those. And I think that will help hasten getting some of these things off our plate.
And Mr. Chairman and Dr. Reimer, I believe we're saying this, but I hope that every policy that comes before us will go through the policy committee at some phase, and the policy committee will get a crack at that policy as it's coming to the board, so that all policies do go through the committee.
That is
at some phase, even if we tweak it along the way.
Every single policy that is pushed from the PLS updates have come through the policy committee, as well as any of the requests from the board. Every single one.
I feel best and safe and most secure when the committee has reviewed the policy and then it's brought to us. And even if it has to go back to the policy committee several times for the full committee to have reviewed all the changes that are made, we need that backing, as you know full well. Thanks a lot. Thank you, Ms. Burns, as well.
All right. Mr. Walter, you did have a couple clarifications that you wanted on policy 2121, board member conflict of interest.
Yeah, let me pull that up first. I think it said number four, it adds under, I guess this is conflict of interest, accept a gift or favor from any person or group, but doesn't say anything about a company. Do we need to clarify that, or does that just give a, is that a way for someone to get around something?
So I spoke with Ms. Stone. I'll let her speak to that.
I would interpret group as being all-encompassing of both informal groups of people as well as possible companies, and I believe the term was probably used intentionally so that people actually couldn't try to thwart the language in the reverse, say, oh, we haven't properly formed a company yet, but we want to talk to the school board about getting contracts with you. And so I do not read the word group as excluding. Rather, I read it as being inclusive of a company, a partnership, an informal organization, whoever it may be who seeks to do business with the board.
I appreciate your interpretation. Just a general layman's term looking at that, it seems like there's a way away around it. But.
That's what he's talking about.
Does that help you with that one, Rob? Okay.
We have an opinion, so that's...
Yeah.
All right,
2123. I think you brought that one up. And 2123 is the board member opportunities for development. And I think you said something about in-house training.
Yeah, I just thought that we could include in-house training as part of the to meet the requirement. And I didn't see it in there. And if the board was okay with that, I would suggest that that be added.
That's true. I know there was... 2 years ago, I think they did TRAGO training for all of us, and that counted as a professional development hour, I believe.
And I think we've had some Windows training when we got upgraded on the computers to go to 10, and that's all counted as relevant training for our positions.
I think it would do us all some good to share some of the training that the teachers and the new teachers and the different categories of teachers might be experiencing for their particular benefit, but for our understanding and for our kind of comprehension of what teachers are really going through. And in the meantime, as peers on the board here seem to be saying, to also be getting that in-house training. To my recollection, most of our training has that I recall for myself has been strictly for board members as opposed to understanding, you know, elements of choice or magnet or aspects of actually performing the teaching job out in the field, and I think it would be very beneficial to us and kill several birds with one stone as well.
So I don't think we have any opposition to that. I don't know if this policy in our attorney's eyes already speaks to that or if we should just add it. I'm fine with her direction.
I mean, I read the current policy as it exists to absolutely encompass both some of the more specific training that Mr. Harrison just mentioned regarding educational issues and teacher issues, as well as providing the opportunity for training to be provided either, you know, externally or internally, because it says, and if you could scroll back up to the top paragraph, please, that it's the responsibility of the boards to provide a thorough orientation to policies, practices, and duties. And so I see it as sort of the board's ability to decide from that how it wants to provide that either internally or externally.
Okay, so are we good the way it's written, or do we need to make sure?
I think I am very comfortable with the way it's written, that we're including both in-house and outside training opportunities.
Okay.
And then 2341, Rob, you had a comment about that one. I think you were talking about the emergency.
Yeah, I just had a question on how we're permitting attendance and voting remotely by telephone, internet, or otherwise in an emergency situation. Why not a regular meeting as well?
Would you phrase that again?
If the policy says now attendance and voting remotely by telephone is permitted at an emergency meeting,
but it's not at a regular meeting. Why is that?
One, just because of a last question, when I know we're going to have some board members absent. We actually talked about this with Mr. Enriquez, so looks like Ms. Stone may be looking something up now. But I know I actually kind of said to Mr. Enriquez, in 2016, you know, why can't you Skype in and vote? And he said there were some statutory things that made that different, that you may could do that, but you'd have to attend the entire meeting. And so he said the law hasn't caught up to that. So I don't know specifically what that is, but we asked that question just in general, is why can't they just do that? And he said the law doesn't permit it, but he didn't refer me to a law. So I don't know if you want to speak to that.
Yeah, that was. And I was pulling up the statutory reference just to make sure I was not misremembering anything, because this is a question that does frequently come up amongst local governments and bodies here in North Carolina, is when is remote attendance and specifically remote voting permitted or prohibited. There is no absolute statutory prohibition on voting remotely. However, if you're going to attend remotely, we have to ensure that whatever the means of attendance are, as Dr. Lauder alluded to, that you're attending for the entire meeting, so that you're counted as attending the entire meeting, as well as we have to make sure we're not going to possibly be violating any of the provisions of the open meetings law. And so there'd be some technological hurdles we would want to overcome, whether we wanted to have you, you know, Skype in on one of the monitors here in the room so that everyone watching could hear and see all the different things. Or I know there are some boards, not of education, I believe some of the other local government boards, who do occasionally allow meetings using, like, for example, 1-800 number of conference call lines, but you have to open the line up and allow the public to listen in and so forth. And so traditionally, and I have not taken a look recently, but traditionally school boards have not allowed regular remote participation and specifically voting by its school board members. If that's something that this board is interested in pursuing, I would recommend this would be one of those items that you all send back to the policy committee, where we could do some further review and see what sort of the current temperature is in the state and how other boards are possibly handling this, and what technology obstacles and opportunities you would have to look at.
Seems that the references there are older than me, and I guess it's quite an understatement to say that the law is not caught up with the technology.
Yeah, it does. No. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
You can? Okay. Yeah. I think if we go that route or investigate that route, the only thing that scares me is it should be a maximum or minimum time you can miss, where I just stay at home at Midland and do the meetings at home. You know what I'm saying? I think that could create an opportunity for us not to be here, and I don't think that's kind of what it's supposed to be.
I think that's a good point, but that's, again, something that you, I guess, review at a committee level and come up with them.
Right now, we can deal with this PLS update, and if you want them to go back, we can send it back and have them just investigate and give us a report on.
Right. I mean, right now, this is just a question. That's what I brought up.
And yeah.
Suggest changing.
Yeah. So he there was no suggestion to change, but if board members, if you would like Ms. Stone and Mr. Enrique to do a little more research for us to see if there are some opportunities, we certainly can have them report back to the policy committee.
Then go ahead and do that.
Okay. We will do that and move this one forward.
Yep. All right. So based on the conversations we've had here tonight, there are five policies that we'll put on the action agenda: 2120, 2400, 3405, 3420, and 2122. Do I have a motion to put the remainder of these on the consent agenda, or a thumbs up?
Yeah, again, though, for the public to find out how the changes are, they have to go to board docs and pull up each individual document to see what actually the changes are to these policies.
Currently, right now, yes, until hopefully this time next week. I also ask that if there are questions, that you guys send those to us so we can do some investigating this week and be able to speak to them next week.
But that will be a one-week window for the public. Is that what we're also saying. How long will these particular policies which have been pulled out be available for public review before we next address them?
So I think once we have our policy meetings and we send them out to the board to start looking at, I think it's also an opportune time to send and put that link on the website at that point. I would also refer to Ms. Stone to make sure she feels comfortable with that. So, but as soon as you receive them after our meeting, right, as a board, we could also add that to the website at that time. So as long
so
as
you... public review is a week, a month, or from varies somewhat.
From the policy meeting to the first read is a couple second. Weeks, but then they get another whole month before it goes to the business meeting.
Plenty of time for the public, yes, to weigh in. Great, thank you.
And also, we're going to address it again at 10 or 12 times.
All right, so board members, now that we put those ones on the consent, the action, and do you all agree with the five that we have on the action agenda?
Yes, sir.
Okay, we'll move on. Good job. All right, this carries us to action items 4.1, academic calendars. Oh, boy. For 2017-18 and... Oh, that wasn't in the notes.
I thought I got away.
This is for 2017-18 and 2018-19. Ms. Reimer and Ms. Burns, show us the way.
So I also handed out earlier, we did not get that in board docs, but it is some of the specifications of our calendar bill that was effective August 21st that hopefully helps explain why these calendars are a little difficult. So we have the 2017 and 18 calendar, which is very, very similar to our 16-17 next year calendar based on our start and end times, and then our 2018-19 calendar, which differs just a little bit. But these are recommendations from our calendar committee for board approval.
Have you all had a chance to look at these? You want to start with the 17-18 and we'll move to the next one?
Can you maybe just go over the changes between the 2 years?
Between the 17-18 and 18-19?
Well, from what exists, what we just approved for this coming school year, as you said, it was very similar. Is there any differences?
Just certain days. Like we start at very similar, the same number of teacher work days before school starts. It's just the date and time, because we have to start the Monday closest to the 26th,
right,
of August. So
again,
that day may move one day or the other.
We're going by hours. We're not going by the...
That is correct. We're doing hours.
Or the number of teacher work.
Whether we're going to have some issues.
So we are obligated for 1,025 hours, okay? And so in 2017-18, we have currently in this calendar 1,041 hours, which gives us some opportunities for our superintendent to possibly dismiss a few of those days, as well as some built-in days in first and second semester that would allow us to pull a teacher work day or something. So I think the calendar committee and the people that worked on that felt like we had, based on the last few years, that we had enough time built in hour-wise as well as teacher work days to accomplish whatever we needed to with inclement weather.
And are teacher planning days or planning hours consistent across both?
Yes.
Calendars?
They are. Again, very similar to this year, in the sense that we have some half days to try to provide that sustainable professional development for our teachers.
What causes the 2018-19 year to end a week later? Because it looks like they're starting at the same time, and I can't really see a whole lot of difference. Why are we ending up with graduation on the 14th and 15th?
So we only have 5 work days at the beginning of the school year, so we have an extra work day in there, as well as the end date has to be the Friday closest to the 11th of June, and so that allows us in this situation to use that last week instead of trying to cram it all in very quickly, if you can see that. So because we can use the 14th as the last day there, that the language around June the 11th in the bill allows that to happen.
So based on arithmetic, on this 18-19 calendar, the 14th is absolute latest date that you could end school?
Correct.
Okay, so that's why you get pushed out.
And it allows us then to not use all of our teacher work days before school and be able to disperse them throughout the year for professional development, for you know, lots of different other reasons that you would want to do that.
So the last day of school could be as early as?
The 7th.
The 8th, right?
7th, so, yeah. However, you still have to fit those days in, so if you did that, you would completely change a lot of the holidays and where your 9 weeks end, and so it's okay. If you push it on one end, you're going to push it out on the other. So
okay, so the 7th then cramps everything.
Really, unless we go back, and we would also then have to add more teacher work days at the beginning of August, so our teachers will be coming back 8, 9, 10 days before kids.
Okay.
I've always wanted to ask this question, but I've never quite known how to. Are we missing any opportunities to give staff a long weekend, or to give staff a teacher work day on a Monday before a election on a Tuesday, so that there isn't a break or a hiccup, so to speak, but that the pace of the week is more manageable for staff, as opposed to having class for a day and then have some period of time off where we really could, you know, accommodate the pace of the staff work a bit better, and I don't mean give them a long weekend, but give them a longer period of time by which they have time to plan and not have to start and stop, so to speak. I'm just generally asking, are there any opportunities out there that we are missing?
I don't think there are that we're missing. I will tell you that the calendar committee was very, very in tune to that, and looked at that and discussed that at every opportune time. If you look at the calendar, you'll see several of those. October has that opportunity. November has that opportunity. March, every time we had the opportunity, we had feedback from our teachers, our teacher assistants, our principals, even parents, saying that's not really good for a parent, but it works great for your school system and the teachers, so we're good with that, or vice versa. So the committee takes that into consideration in every month.
And do the calendars run in tandem with assessments or other regulatory activities, and I'm just very broadly trying to make sure that the calendar comports with activities that we have to perform in order to fulfill state or federal guidelines?
Yes. Again, on our calendar committee, we have principals and teachers there that are very well aware of exams for high schools, or our, you know, pre-testing and testing for elementary schools. And so those are all discussed during our committee meetings, and the calendar's kind of built somewhat around those. If we decided that we wanted a professional development day on a Friday and that's a testing week, then we would all know that, and we use that as part of our decision making.
So how many instructional days do we have on these two calendars?
So the days are a little bit different in both based on the hours. So again, and we look at half days. So when you start talking about days, we just go back to hours. So we don't ever go, actually, it's very difficult to say how many days we have because we have so many half days. So it's according to whether you count a day as a half day or a whole day. So we don't even look at that. We look at 2017, we're going to do 1,041 hours. In 2018, we'll have 1,050 hours. And so that's, which is over, well over the 1,025.
Right, but 2 years ago we had more than that, didn't we?
Yes, absolutely, we did.
And again, that has to do with the states telling us when we can start and when we have to finish.
That's correct.
It's not optimal to...
That is correct, and we currently actually am working with Dr. Lauder on filling out a survey from the state right now on some folks at the state level that are really trying to get a push to possibly to look at those again, and what options do we have. So there's a lot of people that recognize just what you said, that the state limits us on our calendars.
The state limits us, and then the state hammers you if you don't meet certain standards, and they give you less time to do that, and that's... should definitely have local control on what the optimal start date is and when the optimal end date will be.
And so our survey gives us that option to choose, so I'll make sure I speak for you on that, Mr. Walter.
Please do.
And if you got a survey from the NCSBA, Same question was asked there, so please make sure you guys fill that survey out so that our voice is heard in more ways than one.
We really just need to get the legislation passed to give us that flexibility.
Just along those lines, I know that some schools ask for waivers from the rule. What do you have to do in order to get?
So there are some districts that can ask for waivers as a whole, and those districts typically are our mountain districts or someone that shows that year after year they've had a ton of time. There's also special schools like our early college that go obviously with the RCCC and some of those, our balanced calendar school at Wolf Meadow, and there's some lots of talk around those calendars as well. So those are very, very few, and they are now even more limited than they used to be. So those are just a couple.
So what's the penalty if we just decided to make our own optimal calendar?
So so they will not pay our superintendent if we do not meet the calendar.
So now we know how to punish our superintendent. Not that we want to do that, but I did.
Or actually punish ourselves.
Yeah, no kidding. We'd be the ones working harder. We'd be looking for a new superintendent. And it would be very hard to fill that position if it was unpaid.
But I think we would just be taking our local money and not rewarding our students.
Okay.
All right.
Well, I have one last question. Okay. That was kind of going back to David's question about maximizing three-day weekends. I noticed in March there's the second Tuesday in both calendars is a teacher work day. Is that also because we anticipate that's a primary election day? It
yes.
doesn't say it in the calendar.
Correct.
That's
correct.
What's and driving that.
Yes, sir, it is. Also, please know that this is 3 years out, so if the legislators were to do something, we'll bring something different back to you.
And just two last quick questions. Is there any rhyme or reason, I don't mean it in a negative way, is there any calculus to having inclement weather days calculated in here? One of these calendars is 8 days, another calendar is 9 days planned for inclement weather. Is there any, why do we pick 8 or 9 or whatever?
So, well, typically we pick them first and foremost so we can let people know ahead of time and they can plan, because a lot of people plan different when the days aren't capped or aren't mandated. But also according to how many days we have in that calendar and how many hours that we may or may not be over the 1,025. So when you're over the 1,025, it gives the superintendent another option versus making or taking those teacher work days. So when we feel like we have more hours, then we may not have to have as many identified days.
And within the calendar, does a principal have any flexibility, or do these calendars pretty much apply to all schools, all principals, all circumstances, all cases, and that every principal must absolutely adhere to these calendars as we, you know, tweak them over time? But does the calendaring process allow a principal any flexibility, which I know is also regulated by state requirements?
So the only flexibility a principal would have in this would be to determine whether or not they cap some of the teacher work days or not. If they cap and mandate and say, at a school level, we are going to cap this day and you may not use annual leave or one of your leave days for that. The board has to approve any changes to any calendar, and it's expected that every school follow that calendar.
And I do want to commend the calendar committee. They do a wonderful job of coming up with a calendar based on limited circumstances. They've got a good representation of middle schools, elementary schools, staff, teachers, and parents, and board members. So, again, thank you for all the work that's been put into the calendar.
Thank you.
And I would like to note that in 18-19, spring break is going to be very late because the Easter holidays are at the absolute max that they can be based on the lunar calendar. So that's why you see it out there. And they had it, and they had a lot of discussion about, do we do it after Easter or before Easter? And we did it before Easter several years ago, and everybody got a little upset. And so now we're doing it after. And so there are probably those that'll be, that's too late. But it's just pick whatever you wish.
Do we have any sense of when Charlotte Mecklenburg is doing theirs?
No. We do 3 years out, and we were unable to find just about any other districts because our families really are used to that because that's what we've done in the past, and they ask us for that. And as far as the spring break, we initially, our initial draft that we were going to bring to the board did have us going for Easter break before Easter. And so we brought that back to cabinet out of that committee, and Dr. Louder and cabinet said, let's take that back to the committee again. Let's make sure that you're very comfortable when you present that to the board, that that is when we truly want it. We took it back to the committee again, beat it around again, let everybody vote again, and then they moved it and said, we really feel like most people will have it afterwards. And we have some time off in that year already. And it would really kind of push us, in a set where we just had in March, if we don't lose those days, we just had 2 days off, and then we go to school for a week and then have another week off. So there was lots of discussion around that. But typically, most of our school systems that we kind of compare to will be after Easter, but we do not have that information right now.
And I'm sorry, just to ask this question as well. Starting this year, we have one school, which is a year-round program. Do we need to, in effect, see a third calendar, or have we already? How would we handle the Wolf Meadow situation, which is a year-round program in terms of calendaring process?
As I alluded to a little earlier, our state is working on what's allowed in a balanced calendar, and so we will be working on that calendar very soon according to what our state kind of gives us as guidelines, and that you should see that pretty soon. So, yes, you will get a different calendar for them.
Specific for?
Correct. And same thing for early college. We'll also bring those back once they're done.
Gotcha.
So once we get these approved and then early college and some of those, our different schedules, then use our calendar to try to help with theirs.
Thank you.
All right. Consent agenda?
Actually, I'd like to keep this. I don't have any objections to the calendars, but I just think we ought to give the public another week because this is vacation season for a lot of people, and they may not be aware that we're even looking at this.
All right, so we'll put this on the action agenda based on that. Okay, that carries us to 4.2, adoption of the continuing budget resolution. Ms. Klutz. Come on.
Thank you. I think I'm going to settle in. I think I'm the next three agenda items. So for the continuing budget resolution, normally this is something that I would bring to you in June. I failed to bring it to you in June, so I'm bringing it to you today. I'm asking you to vote on it today rather than waiting on August the 8th. This is the continuing budget resolution that allows us to operate without a budget because obviously the state did not have a budget. So that would be July the 1st through August the 8th because we intend to adopt a budget on August the 8th. Are there any questions about the continuing budget resolution?
Ms. Klutz, you and your staff do a marvelous job. Has the state come through with all of their commitments? Can we proceed with the normal?
Let me answer that question.
The first was
the
not
first
a question.
One was,
the first was a general statement about you and your staff,
which I
have high regards for. But is the state caught up with their commitments?
So my next agenda item is the adoption of the budget for 16-17, which is this fiscal year. So the state, the governor signed the budget, the state adopted a budget, and I've processed all the information that I shared with you in July into the budget resolution document that I'm going to talk about in just 1 second. So yes, we have the information to adopt a budget. There are things that are still straggling out there, but not any different than any other year.
All right, but we're focused on a continuing resolution, which is nothing more than allow us to write the checks during the month of July and until we adopt this new budget.
Move for approval tonight.
Okay. All right, so I have a motion to approve from Dr. Phillips. Second was Mr. Walter or Mr. Furr? Tim Furr, I'll give you credit. All right. All in favor of approving the budget resolution, the continuing budget resolution, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That motion carries 5-0. So we now have a continuing budget resolution for 2016-17. That moves us to 4.2A, which is adopt the 2016-17 budget. Ms. Klutz?
Thank you very much. So I feel like I'm explaining, but I also feel like I'm providing knowledge too. So just so that you know, and just so it make me feel a little bit better that I explained it to you. So the governor signs the budget mid-July. Okay, and so at that point, that's when DPI starts processing their information and drops everything down for us. It takes DPI a couple of days. They've done a great job. They have 10 days, but they drop it as quickly as they can. So think mid-July to August 1st. Okay, so you have 2 weeks, 2.5 weeks at the most. So DPI drops down the salary schedules. That's the first thing that we have to do. We have to update all the salary schedules for 4,000 to 5,000 people, and we have to manually adjust basically every principal in AP because the state it has given such complicated rules and requirements for to calculate those salaries. So you can't do a budget until you get the salary changes loaded, or obviously your budget would not be accurate, wouldn't balance very well. So you get those done, and then you start processing the budgets. There's probably about 200 individual budgets that we call program report codes that we balance, and so that's what we've been doing. All of that to say, the reason that this document is not on board docs is because of that period of time. And so I was working until last night finishing this up so that we could have it today because we thought it was important to go ahead and adopt a real budget if we absolutely could. So hadn't been sitting around eating bonbons. I've been working on the budget. So it's just an explanation. Thank you for allowing me to do that.
All right. So this document is different from the one we got on the email.
There's two documents. You should have both of them. Right. One is the budget resolution. It is the formal legal document that I want you to adopt on Monday. And then Mr. Walter asked a couple of years ago if we could have a comparison. Could he see previous years as opposed to this year and the variance? And so this is a document that we've created and used over the last couple of years to explain any changes. I know you just got the document today, but certainly I'll take any questions that you have now or any questions that you have prior to Monday. I can certainly field those. Is there anything that you have?
Board members, do you want a moment just to kind of look through it before you generate some questions?
Well, Ms. Klutz, does anything stand out? Is a few weeks ago I prompted you and you generally said that you felt good that the state was catching up. I don't mean to put words in your mouth, but now that these numbers are here, can you reiterate your feeling about how the state funding and other sources of funding have come through currently, or are there any gaps or any concerns or line items that we should be paying attention to in the near term? Can you give us kind of a quick overview about anything that you want to bring to our attention? Successes are things that are still hanging out there.
So successes, I would say that the state presented and adopted a budget better than we've had in many, many years, and certainly with the pay increases and the additional financial support, it is a good budget. Local phenomenal support locally that we have, and you can see that in the document. And I just want to continue to reiterate how the support of local is just imperative, and we truly appreciate that. The items that concern me are the charter schools at this point. So we do not have a number for new and growing charter schools. Well, there's a number, but it's not a good number. It's kind of out there, and it scares me. There is, if you look, so there are going to be two areas. One on your very first page, when you look down there where it says non-program charges, see that $2.7 million? That's the local portion that goes to charters. There's state money also that's going to go to charters, but the state just takes that money. So, yeah, so you won't see it. It's in here now, but then they're going to have to pull it. There'll be a budget adjustment later in the year, but I've kind of tucked money away anticipating how much I think that's going to be. And so we won't know until the second month of school how many will actually go. So that's my concern. I've tucked away a little bit more in fund balance than I hope that we'll need. Certainly feel a whole lot better if we can just leave that money in fund balance rather than sending it over to charter schools. But we had to balance the budget, and we have to be prepared for that if it happens.
Is the outcome of this the result of what change the state made where they don't give us an estimated number of students, and this is why this is reflecting a $200,000 shortfall? You know what I'm talking about, where we would, in the past, we could estimate that we would project our projection and they would give us what they had projected. Is this based on that as well?
There's a couple pieces to this puzzle. So there's the local component that we have to give to charter schools, and then there's the state component that we give to charter schools. So what you're on the first page that you're seeing there, the $2.7 million, is how much the county has allocated us to us for the purpose of charter schools. They have agreed and put in their contingency to give us more money for the new charters that come in, but again, like the state, they're going to wait to the second month to determine that how much that is. The reason for that reduction, that 180,000 reduction that you're seeing, is because I had to pull to pay our bill last month at the end of June. I had to pull that money out of our Duke Power or our utility account because I had excess money and we didn't have enough charter school money. So the county has agreed to make up that difference for us, and also do the new ones. So a piece of that puzzle is the projections that that we get or we do not get. So when I go through budget season, I try to estimate the charter school numbers. And when there were no new charter schools and there was the cap on the charter schools, then it was pretty easy to project. And, you know, in our size district, it didn't make that much difference. We could financially handle it. The lifting of the cap is huge, and then when we have new ones in our district or in our surrounding area, that's when you worry too. So if you have a school that's going to enroll 600 as a brand new school and you're the county, then, you know, that could be 50% of those students or 60%. We just don't know. With that said, there's more to the story. DPI does try to give us numbers to project the charter enrollments, but their guess is about as good as ours. Our guess actually is probably better than theirs. So the number is high, and we're struggling with it, and communication with DPI indicates, well, that's the reason we haven't taken the money from you, because we're not sure about the accuracy of the number. Lots of pieces to that puzzle.
So where does the state's budget show up in your budget resolution? Because everything seems to say local current expense fund.
Go to page 3, please, section 5.
Okay, because the top one, what happens? Maybe it's because you repeated the header at the top, and that's what's confusing me. On the blue one? The one that shows Ms.
I shouldn't have done that.
Yeah, I think that must be, okay, yeah. I am. Okay.
Page 3, section 5.
Yeah, I figured it out now.
Okay. So $169 million of state dollars. We'll receive additional dollars as the year goes through for various different things, but we're starting with $169
million. So you're going to change that blue on the very top to just say...
I will not.
Just get rid of that completely?
Yeah, I will get rid of it. I won't roll it.
Okay, that'll be perfect. Thanks.
Kelly, are these numbers based on ADM?
A lot of your numbers are based on ADM. So
what is that number thing? Do we know?
So certain allotments are strictly based on ADM. So our instructional supplies based on ADM, our clerical and custodial is based on ADM. Then other things like teacher allotment is not. It's based on the formula of 1 to 18 per grade level or 1 to 21 per grade level, those various different allotment formulas. So is it a true flat ADM number? No, it's not. Can you get one at the end of the day? Yes, and we would.
So they don't share with you what the estimated ADM is that they base their funding on, or is it?
Our projected ADM, is that the number you want?
Yes.
Yes, I can give you that. Let me look it up and send it to you.
But their budget is based on which ADM? Because they don't do a projected?
Mm-hmm. They do the budget. They allocate the state budget on programs that are allocated based on ADM, based on the projected number.
So they're projecting a growth number for us?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because I thought they stopped doing that.
No, they do that.
Oh, they don't do it on the initial budgeting that we do with the county on those first numbers? Because you remember we were kind of going out on a leap of faith?
On charters.
I'm talking about on ADM numbers. At the beginning, the state eliminated the projection 2 years ago.
Okay, you're talking about, they didn't eliminate the projection, they eliminated the growth increase or the normal operational increase for growth schools. So it was built in, if we were going to grow 600 students, it used to automatically be in the budget to add those funds for those 600 students. It was just automatic. It was continuation. But in the budget process, they changed. That has to go through the House, the Senate, the conference, and the governor. So all of those, that's not automatic anymore. It could be changed. But we actually do get a projection. What they're saying is that the money isn't just automatically there with the projection.
I didn't mean to confuse the issue. All right, so this is the actuals.
This is calculated based on our projection that mm-hmm. includes a growth number.
Anyone else have questions? All right, this will be on the action agenda. And that carries us to 4.3, the LEA MAC participation agreement.
Okay, so we're gonna switch gears just a little bit. If you recall, about a year and a half ago, we switched vendors or providers who help us file our Medicaid reimbursement claims. And we went from Fairbanks to a company called PCG. And we vetted that out and went through the process, and the board agreed to do that. So we signed a contract doing that. When we were with Fairbanks, we had a contractual agreement that allowed the money to go from Medicaid to Cumberland County schools, because they were kind of the middle person. And they would hold our money, and then they would disperse our money. So now that we're with PCG, now the third party, the middle person, is DPI. And so this is a contract with Cabarrus County Schools and DPI, because we now have PCG versus Fairbanks and Cumberland. So it is the same operating agreement. We're doing everything that we did before. The audit is the same, the checkpoints are the same, you know, we expect the money to increase a little bit. That's why we changed vendors. But our we reviewed it with the legal, our attorney, and we just need for the board to approve it.
Board members, the reason this got put on the docket, because she just asked me for a signature, is this amounts to close to, what, $800,000?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And if you remember some of the Fund 8 discussion that got pushed off to the side for this year, but it'll be back next year, this would have been part of that. And I wanted you to understand that there's actually something going on behind the scenes, and here's one of your typical Fund 8 issue that comes before us. There's no magic in this contract. It just goes and changes the fact that we've got a different provider,
mm-hmm.
and so that was the only difference. But I wanted y'all to see this before I signed it so that we could move forward. But if anyone has any objections, I would like to see a motion to go ahead and approve this now. And
I'll second that.
Okay. So Mr. Furr moved it, and I heard Mr. Harrison and then Mr. Walter. So a motion to approve the participation agreement has been made. All in favor of this motion, say aye.
Aye.
Oppose? No? None opposed, so that one carries. And that moves us to 4.4, which is done. Onward to 4.5, Mr. Tim Louder, and that is the construction change order at Royal Oaks.
Thank you. As you may recall, we bid this project prior to having DPI approval of all the plans and that sort of thing. And once the bids were taken, we got back final comments from DPI, which required us to add a few things that we argued a little about, but we don't argue with DPI very much. But anyway, what we had to do is add a couple staircases. By doing that, by adding a staircase in the center of the school, we had to modify several things in order not to enlarge the footprint. We had a contractor go back and price all those changes that had to be made in order to accommodate those special DPI requirements. And this is the change order then that catches us up to it. So we began construction with the approved set from DPI with the approved contract price. With this is a $295,000 worth of changes. The architect has approved it. Dave and I have reviewed those and feel that those changes are appropriate. However, we also are asking that if you should you approve this contract here, we need to ask the county for the portion of the contingency funds that were available that they have not yet released to us. There is some allowances in the contract. I talked to Mr. Downs this afternoon about that. If we used 100% of our allowances to cover this now without getting additional funding released from contingency, then we would be pretty much stymied for the rest of the project, which means every little $3,000 or $4,000 or even $10,000 item would have to go back and visit the county commission. I know they love me over there, but I just don't want to have to keep going back every time we have a little small change. So, and he agreed. He didn't want to see my face that often either. So anyway, I think that's where we stand on that.
All right, I'll open this up to the board. Anyone have any comments? Mr. Walter?
$300,000 for a staircase?
Well, it's not all staircase. Okay. That's just the main component of it. Once we had to put a staircase in the center of the corridor on a two-story wing, which we didn't feel like we had to do because we felt like we had all of our exits distances met. Once that staircase was entered, then we had to modify the existing staircase to stay within the same footprint, and then we had to go back and adjust all the walls, all the plumbing, and quite a few things to get us back.
So is this a design change, or this is
it was a design change and construction change
so
altogether.
So the design change and construction is included in this description?
Yes. There was no charges for the design change. Oh. That's up to the architect. That's their responsibility to meet that DPI requirement. But this is all construction monies associated with that.
Yeah, I think when they put a description on a change order, post-bid addendum is not sufficient. I think we need more than that for such a large amount.
We can give you the breakdown of from the contractor if you wish, for the actual breakdown of all the individual items that were changed if you need to as
I
far
think
as back
the public
for
deserves to see what that change is, yes.
Okay.
From your experience, are these additional charges in line with just from your experiences?
Yes, we've actually reviewed them with the architect, and Dave, like I say, I've looked at them, and we feel like, based on what they asked us to change, the charges were in line. We were expecting this. That's why we had a contingency the way we did set up in line. We were anticipating probably maybe to this scale of changes because of DPI comments. Anyway, we did have to modify the plan quite significantly in order to fit the site.
And your staff has worked in a lot of detail with the architect, obviously,
yes,
and the county.
Back and forth on what we did, some negotiating and some changes in the extension of time, which actually decreased. It was over 300,000, but they wanted more days, and we would not give them more than, they wanted 28 days, I believe it was. We asked them down to 14. That changes the overhead and the construction management charges, as well.
And we're still on schedule to follow through with opening Royal Oaks.
Well, right now we're on schedule. We're still having some difficulty getting all the building demolished because of some additional asbestos issues we found or some hazardous materials we had to remove from the site, which has delayed the demolition probably about 2 weeks.
Right.
But the portion that has already been demolished is not holding up the construction, which was the critical path item.
Right. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Your staff
how
as well.
How are we doing on the Adele project?
We're getting it done. But no, I would laugh. Okay, this,
let's finish this one, and then we can let him give us an update. All right. Anybody else have any input on this? If not, is it consent or action?
They can change the description.
I will give you, I'll probably have the description, but I'll give you the backup that shows you the detail.
I think the detail needs to be provided before I go with consent, but if it is, I will go with consent.
Okay. So did you say?
If the detail is provided on this $300,000.
Yeah, because you gave us in the construction committee the details. So.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. That's so just give us what you gave us in that meeting. Okay, so.
Yeah. Pat, we'll go ahead and include that statement of all those, and I'll make sure they include it in your backup.
And we didn't have him prepared to give us an Odell update. Would you all like to have that in the weekly wrap-up so that he can give us a complete update? And that will.
Yes, please.
It's supposed to open this short month, right? So everything's.
Yep.
Yes, sir.
Maybe at the next meeting.
And then we can talk about it in the next meeting. So if you could get it in the wrap-up this week, and then we can
we're happy to give
talk
you
about it at the end of the next meeting. Okay. All right. So then that does bring us to the new Odell School energy easement agreements.
In the widening of Odell School Road, Duke Power is required to move a couple, or has to move a couple poles in order to accommodate that, and be able to move their poles their desired distance off the edge of the pavement. They will fit within the existing right-of-way on site, let's say that up front. But Duke wanted to modify the right-of-way agreement so that their poles would still be in the center of the right-of-way. So they are requesting that we provide this change in easement, which allows the poles, as you can see there, on the site to be moved back 10 feet into the site. They had at one time requested the far right pole there that you see that ties in to be moved back, to be moved back 4 feet in order to be create a different alignment. However, that was going to require the pole to be closer to the large mature trees that we spent a lot of time and effort to preserve there. And we felt like that was just not in our best interest to allow that to be encroached further into that tree line. So at that time, we bring forward, you know, had two different options, and the option we feel like is better for us is to go ahead and keep the pole where it is and only move the two. And this easement then falls into that alignment for the poles. We felt like Duke could do it without having another easement, but they said, you know, they kind of heavy-handed us just a little bit here and saying, give me an easement, I won't move your poles. That's kind of what we are.
Is it a whole dollar amount?
Yes, sir. A big pay item. Yes, sir.
All right. Is that consent?
Is this required for the school to open?
Yes, sir. Well, the turn lanes are, but obviously it needs to be moved so we can get the turn lanes in.
Okay. So won't the
Duke says if we sign this easement, they'll move the poles.
It's not delaying the opening of the school?
It's delaying putting the turn lanes in, which would, in turn, delay the school if we could not do it.
The what?
It's delaying the installation of the turn lanes on the Odell side.
Okay, but we approve it today.
They will move it this week.
Yep. Consent?
This is one of those things we'd like to have a vote on tonight.
Okay,
please.
So I need a motion. Mr. Furr, seconded by Mr. Harrison, to sign the agreement, the consent agreement. All in favor of this motion, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Oppose? That motion carries 5-0.
Thank you.
And we'll sign that tonight. All right, that carries us to our final act of open session business, which is to convene in closed session. I need a motion and a second for the board to convene in closed session pursuant to General Statute 143-318.11A3 to consult with an attorney, employed or retained. Also, General Statute 143-318.11A6 to consider the qualifications, competence, etc. And finally, General Statute 115C-319 through 321. Do I have a motion to move?
I'll
Mr. Harrison?
I'll make it as you stated it.
And Mr. Walter, all in favor of going into closed session, say aye.
Aye.
Oppose? Say no. Okay. This meeting is adjourned.